Rock 102, Springfield's Classic Rock. It's 5:36 on Rock 102 with Dax and Nagel and Marty Caproni, still filling in for Steve.
Still upright. Haven't passed out yet.
Yeah, we'll have to talk about that because that kind of commitment to this. I'm kind of blown away by it.
I got to be honest. While I was driving to the show, and I was watching the slew of rescue vehicles going north with me, I was thinking, what am I doing? What am I doing driving with a big old smile? I'm getting dragged to do comedy today. Yeah. Driving up there to do comedy when I was driving basically into a natural disaster, a declared natural disaster.
Yeah, comedy and radio are not worth dying for.
No, but hopefully I won't be so overtired that I turn this into a natural disaster.
Let's hope not. It's going to be a sunny to partly cloudy today, a high of 91. Tomorrow, overcast. And here's something to look forward to. There's a possibility of a stray shower or a thunderstorm with a high of 89. We'll talk about all kinds of stuff today, including all the flooding that's going on.
Yeah.
Things are not great out there. We'll talk in detail about that. It's 5:37 with Bax and Nagel and Marty Caproni at Rock 102.
Springfield's
Rock 102, Springfield's Classic Rock. It's 5:53 and Aerosmith with Bax and Nagel and Marty Caproni on Rock 102. Sunny to partly cloudy today, a high of 91. Tonight, a few clouds, low of 67. And then for tomorrow, overcast. And there is a chance of a stray shower or a thunderstorm possible with a high of 89. 64 degrees right now in downtown Springfield. Marty Caproni is filling in for Steve. He'll be back on Monday. So I will tell you this now, folks. Marty is running on fumes. So we'll see how deep into the show you'll go before it completely falls apart.
You just start hearing a light snoring around 8 o'clock. That is me sitting here asleep at the switch.
So you did a show last night.
I did a show about 4 hours north. So I finished the show here. Basically went home, grabbed a bag of stuff, drove up there, caught about a 3 hour nap in the room they gave me there, did the show, caught like another hour nap, and then drove back and was here bright and early.
Unbelievable.
And then I will leave here, try to catch a little nap, and then we'll be at Loft Comedy Club tonight.
Yeah.
And I will be on stage, this is true, opening for Mark Norman all four shows. So I'm going to be, by Friday, I'm going to be an absolute zombie, basically.
Well, perfect. We'll try to, yeah. we'll try to pad that show with as much stuff as we can possibly squeeze into it. But I can't believe, I mean, 4 hours north. I mean, that's a hell of a drive.
Yeah, and I'll tell you, I don't want to be an alarmist, but for those, like we were talking about, people who have the boats in the river and stuff, or people who live on the river or whatever, the only thing I can say after seeing kind of what I saw up there is if it takes a day or two to get down this way, oh boy, I'm worried about down here because it's dicey up there, man, real dicey.
And it's starting to affect, you know, areas around here. We'll talk about that during news and later on this morning. The Oxbow crested yesterday.
Yeah.
And they had to shut down, you know, Route 5 in both directions for a period of time.
Yep.
Now, that may, and I believe that they're reassessing it today, whether they will be able to open it today. But based upon what you're hearing about what's coming up from the north, you may not have that option.
Yeah, I mean, I don't know how water works because I'm dumb. But if it is a delay before it comes down here, I know. And I'll tell you, like little signs that I was headed into stuff like stopping at the gas station 91 and being behind eight guys from the Greenboro Urban Search and Rescue Squad where they're mm-hmm. towing a raft, a Zodiac with the motor on the back, and they're all ready to pull people out of rivers and everything else. You're like, geez, this must be real bad, you know?
No, it's the real deal. And like I said, we'll talk about this more at length later on. The thing is, you know, and I was reading this morning too, you know, a lot of people think, well, all you got to do is just, you know, swim to safety and you'll be fine.
Oh, sure.
Yeah, you're not really supposed to swim in that stuff. One, the water is filthy and disgusting.
Effluent.
Very effluent. And then it's not so much that the water is flowing. It's what's flowing with it.
yes, logs, trees, stuff you don't see underneath the surface.
Yeah. So you could easily get crushed or killed just by thinking, it's just a few feet of water. What could possibly happen?
I mean, I have some friends that are like, I could see them being like, I'm going out in the river this weekend anyways. My advice would be don't. That would be my advice, Go see Doug Key Saturday at Love.
And that's on a high elevation area too, right?
So yeah, we're on top of a hill.
And
the club is on the second floor, so you're gonna be fine.
It's not gonna be like comedians on top of the roof waiting to be rescued.
We'll have life preservers there in case anyone needs them for any reason whatsoever, as long as it sells tickets.
It's coming up on 5:58 with Bax and Nagel and Marty Caproni at Rock 102.
It's time.
Time to
6 a.m.
right now.
And now, Bax's View from the Couch, brought to you by Rocky's Ace Hardware, your grilling headquarters, Weber, Big Green Egg, Uni Pizza Ovens, and Traeger Wood Fired Grills.
Hey, good morning, sports fans. How the heck are you? Hey, not to make anybody jealous, but in my house, I currently have a beautiful 42-inch flat-screen TV. With high-definition picture quality, loads of pixels, and color as sharp and as vibrant as opening up a window and looking around. And while I'm sure that me and the missus are the envy of the neighborhood, the New England Patriots have now got me thinking about making an upgrade. The next time you find yourself going to Gillette Stadium for a Patriots home game, you will no doubt notice that they've made some improvements to the joint. And among those improvements include the brand new 22,200 square foot video monitor that's been placed in the end zone. Yesterday, the Patriots revealed pictures of the new video screen, which is not only five times the size of the screen that it'll be replacing, it happens to be the largest outdoor video board in the country. The surface covers approximately a full half acre of space and will give you a mind-blowing picture that includes a reported 20 million pixels. How many pixels does my TV have? 6. Now, as I'm reading about this yesterday, I cannot help but think that even though the stadium is looking at more than $250 million in upgrades and improvements, including a 360-degree observation deck and a 218-foot tall lighthouse, to bring the fishing boats safely to the shores of Foxborough, I cannot help but think that perhaps my living room might not be big enough for a 22,000-square-foot TV. I'm also thinking that this thing's going to require an enormous remote, which of course will get lost every 3 days in between the cushions of the couch. The biggest problem with this thing is that no matter how wide or how clear the picture might be, it still won't make the Patriots look any better, especially during that tough divisional schedule. Because if they play like they did last season, you're going to have 65,000 fans begging Mr. Kraft to change the channel. But hey, enough of my yapping. Sports brought to you by Rocky's Ace Hardware, the Ego battery-powered trimmer and blower, the battery and charger included. Now $229 at Rocky's with your Ace Rewards card. You're saving almost $100. And I'm looking at the Rocky's app. You can pick up the flyer in the store. What's on sale at Rocky's? It's always at your fingertips. I'm back. That's my view from the couch.
Rock 102, Springfield's classic rock.
Rock 102, Springfield's Classic Rock at 6:10 in Journey with Bax and Nagel and Marty Caproni filling in for Steve for the remainder of the week. Steve will be back on Monday just in time to start planning his next vacation, which is coming up surprisingly soon. this I found out about yesterday.
Uh-oh.
We may be talking to comedy legend Yakov Smirnoff this week.
I know.
Everybody in the audience is... gasped and said, "Ooh, I can't believe they're getting the
Yakov Smirnoff.
Yes. Yeah. Is this a great country or what? That guy. Yeah. So that's probably Friday we'll be talking to him.
Well, I'm excited. I mean, when I was a kid, I always wanted to be a comedian. My father would let me watch Carson on Friday nights. I'd watch the stand up. And you'd see Seinfeld, Stephen Wright was a big one, and Yakov Smirnoff, you'd see those guys on there, and so I'm a little bit of a fan.
You know that Mike Scully, right?
Yeah.
Okay, so Mike Scully.
Simpsons.
From Mike Simpsons, Scully, right? Mike Scully.
Yeah, sure.
He's been on our show a billion times. He used to write for Yakov Smirnoff.
That's amazing.
Which I'm thinking, well, thank God your career was able to suddenly find success after something like that. Some people would bury that in the resume pretty deep, but that's how he kind of started.
It'd be funny if all the Simpson episodes, the early Simpson episodes, you go back and you watch, you're like, it makes sense because all the accents are there, like the broken English. It's a great country or what, Bart?
So you did a show last night in Vermont.
Yeah, New Hampshire, Vermont, yeah. So all the way up there, and then I went through up 91 all the way to get to New Hampshire. So I saw the river the whole, you know, most of the way up, and it's bad up there.
You were telling me, and I hadn't even heard this yet, but Lake Okemo Mountain.
Yeah.
Is in bad shape.
Yeah, I heard that last night. One of the guys at the show told me it, and I was like, "You got to be kidding me," you know. And it says real bad.
This was from 2 days ago. 4 inches of rain fell on over in southern Vermont. So this would have been Monday. Okemo is understandably closed for summer operations as the town of Ludlow, Vermont, tries to clear the roads, but they're showing video and pictures of what Okemo looks like. I mean, there's
war zone.
Mudslides.
Yep.
There's a lot of damage that's gone on here. So we don't know the extent of this and when they'll be able to reopen. But that's only one thing that's been damaged from the rains and the high water.
The craziest thing that really stood out to me, you know, whenever you drive through like Vermont or New Hampshire, you see on the side of the road those big rock formations, and you in the springtime you'll see a little bit of like a trickle coming down.
Yeah.
You know, there were full on waterfalls. You know what I mean? Almost look like you're in Hawaii at points. You know what I mean? Just raging waterfalls over the sides of those things.
Yeah.
So when that comes down this way, you know, because both of those states are mountainous, so nothing sits on a plain and soaks into the ground. It all goes into a river or a stream.
The water levels are expected. Yeah, well, yesterday, the National Weather Service said that areas are categorized as flood stage when water reaches 9 feet. The Connecticut River in Holyoke was just shy of that at 8.8 feet. That was as of 2 o'clock yesterday. So, I mean, you're practically there. 8.8, you know, you're like inches away from being designated as potential, you know, like flood problems.
When on 91 last night, you could see it to the west. You could see lightning and stuff like that, and you know, like not heavy rains, but like a little bit of rain. So you know that over that part, they're still getting rain. If it rains again today, God forbid, you know what I mean? It's just going to get worse.
We'll talk about this more in news, but the Oxbow crested yesterday.
Yep,
that shut down Mount Town Road, and they'll reassess that early today to find out when they could reopen or if they can reopen today. The docks at Brunel's Marina were damaged because of the increased water level.
Well, as I was driving by the Oxbow at whatever 4 a.m. or whatever on the way here, I looked to the right and you could see the water was up almost to where that building is. You know what I mean? Like someone had a boat up in the parking lot there, and I saw the water up that way. So it was, man.
See, you know. I always judge whether we've had too much rain by driving past Heritage Park here in East Longmeadow,
where the ducks are sitting,
where the swans are wondering what's going. When did this get so big? When the park benches are now in the middle of the pond.
Well,
when that happens, I'm thinking, okay, maybe we're at a high level.
Yeah. Yeah, well, that's the East Longmeadow version of waterfront property, I guess.
that's the best they can do. That's a park that's had a lot of great planning over the years.
I worry about these people like along the river in places like Agawam and stuff like that. Like, you know, it's awesome to have a house on a river or a lake, but when something like this happens, yikes!
It's rough, and then also a lot of local farmers are having a big problem now. There's some farmers in Northampton and in other areas that you know their crops are getting devastated because you know there's no way to save your farm if you're getting flooded out.
Nope.
I mean you're just talking about a total calamity if you're a farmer.
Which is it's a double-edged sword. You know what I mean? Because you know those fields are so fertile because over the years the floodplains there drops all the sediment, which is rich, which helps them plant and have fertile soil and everything else. But it's so bizarre to have this happen in July and not in March or April that, you know.
Here's how important this is. Here we are talking about, you know, the rising levels of these waterways, rivers, ponds, you know, what have you. And we're not even talking about the contamination of the wastewater treatment plants.
Are you saying we need an update for the turd cast?
I was not able to find many stories this morning that was talking about how many millions of gallons are expected to come in the next couple of days.
You know what? They probably just opened up the gates or like, hey, let's just stop keeping track. Let's just get it out of here.
Dump all of it. just be done with it.
Oh, God. Well, I thought you were going to say, you know it's bad because we're not talking about Yakov Smirnoff anymore. I was going to say, wait till he comes in. What a great country with all the flooding.
We'll let him sell his own sizzle. How about that?
Yeah, that's fine.
But, yeah, I mean, you look at some of the video of what's going on out there, some of the pictures. It's unbelievable.
It really is.
I mean, I feel bad for somebody who lives close to the river. Not even just because it's, you know, waterfront property, but they live close enough to be affected by a crested river.
Well, if you're like one of these places, like up there, like New Hampshire, they're right on the Connecticut River, like, you know, like just above, you know, in Brattleboro, they have that restaurant that's like half of it is in Vermont.
The other half is in New Hampshire. Yeah.
Like there's houses right around there that are on that. So, you know, those people are probably, you know, day to day, hour to hour, wondering if they're going to have a house.
They showed video yesterday of Montpelier.
Oh my gosh.
Yeah, the whole city is underwater.
Yeah, we saw that when we were sitting here. It was on over my shoulder, and I turned around and looked. It doesn't look like something you expect in New England. It looks like something you expect like along the Mississippi when you see that in the news, you know?
Yeah. Well, you know, a lot of times I think we get this false sense of security by thinking, well, you know, that could never happen to us.
Right.
You know, I'm well above sea level. I mean, I'm at least, you know, 3 or 4 inches above sea level. That'll never happen here.
Right.
I'm in good shape. The hell it wouldn't. The hell it wouldn't.
Well, I used to think that about Western Mass. I used to think, well, at least we live here and we're not really prone to natural disasters. We can't really have earthquakes. There's no volcanoes. Mm-hmm. And then the tornado hit, and I was like, oh, it turns out that we're like one of the more active places in the country for tornadoes. Yeah, you live and you learn. You know what I mean? Like,
and then you have an earthquake like 2 months later. How did that happen?
Right, right.
And then a microburst.
Right.
And then a gas explosion, which ruins a strip club.
That was a real tragedy.
That was the one that I felt an emotional loss for.
That was, depending on how the ladies had surgery or not, was either a very unnatural disaster.
How nobody got killed in that, I don't know. But I remember the news stories and the pictures in the paper of like all this debris and a single shoe. It was worn by the dancer, like a pump, just sadly lying there in the street.
I remember I was on the road. I might have been in Syracuse, New York, or something like that, and was in the green room, and the news came on about it. And my phone, you know, obviously lit up immediately. Hey, are you downtown? Just making sure what's going on, blah, blah. Yeah. And then someone was asking me, like, you know, I said, well, my first thought is I hope no one was hurt. My second thought is I hope it's not a terrorist. My third thought is, if you're a terrorist, what a dummy you are.
Well,
we're
going to
blow up downtown Springfield.
Yeah,
everyone's like, okay.
But, I mean, I remember sitting in my living room in East Longmeadow. Now, granted, it's a few miles away from downtown, but hearing the noise and then feeling the percussion of it, like, you know, physically feeling.
Yo, you felt it.
Yeah, you could feel it. I mean, it was, you know, it wasn't, yeah, I didn't, was knocked. Not knocked off my feet.
No, but you could, you definitely knew something had happened.
Yeah, it wasn't like, you know, someone, you know, dropped a load from a truck. It was something a little bit more than that.
Yeah.
But, you know, I don't know if you saw the story in Mass Live yesterday talking about how Springfield rebounded from the explosion and the tornado and all those natural disasters that happened all at once, you know, how they found a way to pick things up. And find a way to thrive after that, and not all related to MGM, but other things that have happened. It's actually a pretty interesting story.
Yeah, well, you know, I mean, you look at downtown now, and hopefully it's on the rebound, you know what I mean? It looks nicer. Worthington Street seems like it's coming back alive. Jackalope and those new restaurants going in there, and they got the lights going across the street. So if nothing else, it's a fancier place to get stabbed. But
yeah, right. And not to be all over the place, but you know, here's Springfield recording its 16th homicide of the year. 16 out of 250,000 people. They can't kill all of us.
And they were well-lit homicides.
Yeah, you know,
with accent lighting is really good.
Not just broad daylight, but just, you know, well-lit. It's 6:22 with Max Nagel and Marty Caproni on Rock 102.
You've seen him at
102 Springfield's Classic Rock. It's 6:28 and the Beatles with Max and Nagel and Marty Caproni on Rock 102. It's going to be, sunny today, partly cloudy. I don't see a lick of rain in the forecast until tomorrow, where it could be overcast, a stray shower, or a thunderstorm. That is a possibility with a high of 89. It's 68 degrees right now in downtown Springfield. Great comedy show coming to the Loft tonight and tomorrow night. I'm happy to say I'll be going tonight for the early show.
I'm excited.
Yeah.
I'm excited that you surprised me. I would have got your tickets, Bex. You put up with me talking about it enough, you know, and you went ahead and just bought them.
Did we just have the conversation yesterday where I said, well, I don't feel like I'm entitled to really anything?
You are.
Well, no. I mean, I'm not going to go to you and say, listen, I know you got a big show, and I know it's going to be a really important one for the club, but is there a way I could go without having to pay? And I didn't want to do that.
Well, all you had to do is mention you wanted to go.
I'll do that in some of your crappier shows.
All right, perfect.
Yeah.
Come see me when I'm there. I'll pay you, Max. I'll pay you.
Oh, good. Perfect. Perfect. No, I'm actually looking forward to it.
It's Mark's really good. He's great. So,
yeah.
And hopefully I'll be upright and able to form sentences by then.
You're going to need someone to crack open the smelling salts to revive you this afternoon?
Maybe we could do a ventriloquist routine where I just sit on your lap and you jam your hand up from behind me and make me talk.
I would like to think I wouldn't have to jam my hand inside of you to do that.
I mean, I guess that's overkill.
I mean, it's a little bit much. I can just put my hand on your back hand on my lap so it looks like my hand's up there when I'm not actually even touching you.
Well, I haven't been to my doctor in a few years to get my screening, so I was just trying to kill two birds with one stone.
Anyway, that's tonight and tomorrow night. Two shows are the...
Two shows, yeah. There's an early and a late show both nights. The early show for Thursday is already sold out. The late show for Thursday is climbing fast. And the show for the early show tonight is almost sold out. It will sell out the way it's trending. And the big one that I'm telling people, the late show for tonight is going to be probably the smallest of the four shows. But I feel like that's going to be kind of fun because when it's a lighter crowd, I mean, they're all four shows are going to be fun, but I feel like that one's going to be one where we horse around a whole bunch.
Oh, good. So that's tonight at the Loft Comedy Club, View Street in Chicopee.
Yep.
6:30, we got news next to Rock 102.
When I'm not voicing Wendy's ads, I'm gaming. I stay up and fueled because Wendy's delivers late.
Are you recording a Wendy's ad? Come on!
Got him. Whatever you're up for, we're down. Choose wisely. Choose Wendy's delivery late night.
Delivery hours may vary.
Are you tired of 6:32 with Bax and Nagel and Marty Caproni and Rock 102. It's time for news brought to you by Gary Rum Hyundai. Go to Gary Rum Hyundai today. Get 0% financing on select models. Listen to this. I think this story is pretty fascinating. Charles Manson follower Leslie Van Houten, former homecoming princess who at 19 helped carry out a series of shocking killings of wealthy Los Angeles couples and at the directive of Charles Manson himself, has now served 50 years of a life sentence. She is now being released to parole supervision after all this time. She left California's Institution for Women in Corona, east of Los Angeles, in the early morning hours and was driven to a transitional housing facility. That's according to her attorney, Nancy Tatro. Days earlier, Gavin Newsom, the governor of California, announced that he would not fight a state appeals court ruling that Van Houten should be granted parole. He said it's unlikely the state Supreme Court would consider an appeal either. The 1969 slayings and subsequent trials captivated the nation during an era of strife marked by Vietnam and the civil rights movement, a couple of assassinations. But when you consider the crime or crimes that she was a part of.
Yeah.
I can't believe they're letting someone in the Manson family go.
Well, let me say this. I feel for the victims, for the families, you know, but I am not surprised. I know you can't believe it. I can believe it because Gavin there, the governor of California, is one of the same guys who's all for the experimental policy in San Francisco where you pay the homeless people for not committing crimes. They get like a stipend every month because they didn't get arrested.
Well, if someone paid me not to commit a crime, I'd take it.
Yeah, I mean, we do that every month.
I would curtail my criminal activity.
Sure, sure. It's so bizarre to me that, I mean, she was rotting away. No one cared. What's the upside of letting her?
Well, I know there's no upside, but I think when you're holding people down while they're being stabbed to death, yeah. I think that, you know, there's a certain culpability in all that.
Yeah, you're 19 years old, really bad decision, but we're not talking about, like, I got a bad tattoo. We're not talking about, you know, I committed a crime. You're talking about violently, savagely murdering people.
Yeah.
And we're okay with that now?
Apparently, if you can serve 50 years, and she has, then good luck. I don't know how someone like that goes out into in regular civilization for the first time since the 70s.
What do you think her
and transitions back into regular life?
What do you think her first move is when she gets out? Like after the halfway house? Like what do you think her first move is? Steak?
I would think a real
trip to the Men in Motion show.
Yeah, maybe that's what it is. I would think dinner, like a good dinner, sit-down dinner.
A nice dinner?
Yeah.
Plastic forks and knives, though.
Oh, yeah. Oh, that. Actually, I would have everything
pre-cut.
Don't hand
her a steak knife.
Yeah, like, maybe like just sandwiches, nothing that requires utensils. Residents of the Pioneer Valley near the Connecticut River woke up Tuesday morning under a flood warning as Western Mass Central's central waterways and tributaries threatened to overrun their banks over the last couple of days. The National Weather Service flood warning extended from the Vermont border south along the pathway of the Connecticut River to Holyoke. In Vermont, the situation was potentially life-threatening in some areas. The Weather Service in Burlington said the full state was under a flood warning or a much serious flood watch. In the Pioneer Valley, the Weather Service projected moderate flooding along the Connecticut River from Greenfield to Holyoke. Even with clearer skies in the forecast for Tuesday and today, areas along the Deerfield River could see minor flooding. That's according to the agency. And the Weather Service advised pedestrians to stay cautious when walking near riverbanks and urged drivers to avoid flooded roadways and to not bypass barricades. Now, that's important to know that if you're going to be one of those looky-loos that wants to see what the river looks like, if you're walking by the banks of a river, sometimes what can happen is the earth beneath your feet can also get washed away. And when that happens, you could fall into the river and die.
Especially if you're like my size or your size. Probably not. I don't think either of us would be walking on a riverbank, right?
What, athletic types like us?
Yes, exactly what I was talking about. Of course, that's what I meant. What do they always say to reporters? Don't become the news. Don't become the story.
Yeah, right.
Yeah. You're doing that, you're going to become the story. You know what I mean? Eventually, that's going to happen.
Remember the old joke from Ron White? Talking about, like, you know, people sticking around their houses during a hurricane, and they refuse to leave.
Yeah.
And I'm going to ride it out. Yeah, I'm going to ride it out. The line was, it's not so much that the wind is blowing. It's what it's blowing. It's kind of the same thing in flood waters.
Right.
You know, branches and trees that you can't see from the surface may be, you know, down along the floor of the flood, and you could just get, you know, swiped out without even knowing it.
Yeah. If you're the dummy, and there's always one out there that's like, you know what, though? I'm going to take the kayak, and I'm gonna go out this. Don't do it.
Yeah. Big mistake.
Yeah.
So, yeah, I mentioned before, according to the National Weather Service, areas are categorized at flood stage when waters reach 9 feet. The Connecticut River at Holyoke is just shy of that, hitting 8.8 feet as of 2 o'clock yesterday afternoon. You had problems with the docks at Brunel's Marina. Some of them have been damaged due to the flood advisory. The Oxbow crested yesterday, Mount Tom Road, Route 5 near the Oxbow, closed in both directions until further notice. They'll reassess whether they can open that early this morning. That's according to Northampton Police. You get farms being flooded out, Mountain View Farm, Acadian Wildlife Sanctuary, all talking about potential issues with crops. AccuWeather, again, another weather service, estimating that heavy rains across western Mass, Vermont, eastern Pennsylvania, northwest New Jersey, the lower Hudson Valley of southern New York, and New York City, that these floodwaters could cause $3 to $5 billion in damage to rural communities, hardest hit, and they're likening it to Hurricane Irene back in 2011.
Makes me think of the poor people up in Shelburne Falls. I'm sure that's probably a mess up there now. I saw one picture of it. It looked like it was pretty bad. They get it bad coming down from Vermont and New Hampshire too up there. You said AccuWeather and made me think, wouldn't it be great if there was an inAccuWeather where they're just
that's called the National Weather Service.
Yeah, okay. Perfect.
Because it's all inaccurate. Springfield police confirmed yesterday that the city saw its 16th homicide after a fatal shooting on July 7th outside 39 Commonwealth Avenue. Police spokesman Ryan Walsh said the patrol officers responded to a shot spotter activation shortly before 5 a.m. Officers located the subjects in the incident, including an adult male suffering from a gunshot wound. It is the 16th homicide of 2023. Meanwhile, in Westfield, a Springfield man arrested for the attempted murder of a man in Westfield Monday night after firing a weapon into the residence of his ex-girlfriend's current boyfriend. Because that will teach them a lesson. Nicholas Johnson Nicholas Elliott, 35, at Johnson Street in Springfield, pulled up in a Ford Mustang in front of a single-family home on Delancey Street in Westfield and began firing into the building. Moments later, the occupant of the home, Elliott's ex-girlfriend's new boyfriend, came out of the house, returning fire at Elliott, who was sitting in his vehicle. Neither man was injured during the exchange. But the guy, Elliot, was charged with attempted murder, discharging a firearm within 500 feet of a dwelling, possessing a firearm without a firearms NFID card, possessing ammunition without a firearms FID card, and many, many more. He is scheduled to he was arraigned on 6 felonies yesterday, and details of the arraignment are not immediately released.
Well, if you had gone to FID school to get your thing, they would probably tell you drive-bys. Not safe and very illegal.
Yeah. Listen, I know that, your ex-girlfriend has moved on to another guy. I understand that, I believe it was the great Neil Sedaka who said that breaking up is hard to do.
Yeah.
But, let it go.
Let it go.
Go and mingle with new people.
Also, stop watching so many action movies. All right. The shooting up houses like it's a Die Hard movie. Oddly enough, the guy in the house coming out and returning fire, everyone in Westfield must be like, what the heck is going on in this neighborhood? Well, you know what's going on? You're not far from Springfield. So,
I mean, I don't know much about your dating life in your youth or about your relationships. I can tell you this. This is a bit of advice. If you're going to shoot at your girlfriend's current boyfriend, she's not coming back to you.
Imagine.
It actually creates more separation rather than brings you together.
Imagine she says, you love me that much.
Oh, how romantic.
How romantic.
Then she calls her little girlfriend. You're never going to believe what he just did for me. He must really care.
Shot up the whole house.
Why did I leave him? Yeah. He's such a warm,
well-adjusted guy.
Calm dude. I don't know what I was thinking. No winner in last night's Mega Millions jackpot. The jackpot now grows to $560 million for Friday night's drawing.
Oh,
meanwhile, tonight, the Powerball jackpot, an estimated $725 million.
Gotta get that Powerball ticket today.
Bought tickets.
After my nap, before my two shows.
Bought tickets yesterday for both games.
Oh, all right.
I haven't checked the numbers yet because I just naturally assume it ain't going to be me, even though I contributed.
Don't count yourself out.
I know. I'm not out of it yet.
If you win, I have a feeling that 209 2,987 days now is going to be shortened significantly.
Dramatically.
I think by at least 3 or 4 days, right?
Well, I think by almost by 2,800 days.
How would you leave if you won Powerball? How would you leave radio? Would you just come out here and say all 7 dirty words that the FCC has?
No. I'm not the kind of guy that's going to go out in a blaze of glory like that. I'm not going to leave in an explosive fashion.
You'd leave as a professional?
I certainly would.
You wouldn't come out here and just with a list of people that you're just sick of after 20 years of being out here and just unload on them all?
It's not to say that list doesn't exist.
Okay, good. All right.
But I'm not sure I would reveal it on the air. That's something that may be like a personal discussion.
You're a better person than I am.
Yes.
Because I know if I won that kind of money and I had to come in here and fill in... Every time we broke for the news, I'm like, and the latest news, you know, my old neighbor, I would just, every story would just be someone I hated and an axe to grind.
Yeah. Well, I mean, everyone's built differently. Everybody's, everybody's sense of, everybody's axe is grinded differently.
I didn't say it was built correctly.
Yeah. Our axes are all different. The Pioneer Valley forecast, again, looking like this. Sunny to partly cloudy. A high of 91 today. Tomorrow, overcast. A stray shower or a thunderstorm is possible with a high of 89. New Springfield Classic Rock. It's 6:53 and Collective Soul with Bax and Nagel and Marty Caproni on Rock 102. Real quick, if you missed any part of today's show, check out the daily podcast. It's going to get posted sometime after 10 o'clock today, you know, when I get around to it. And then also listen to Baxi's musical podcast this week. Joe Keithley from the band DOA, the Canadian hardcore band. Really interesting interview from a guy who is not only a musical legend, but also a 2-time elected city councilor in Burnaby, British Columbia. This is the second time I've talked to Joe. He is an unbelievable guy and legendary in some circles. But yeah, he's an elected official in the third largest city in British Columbia.
Those are my favorite people to talk to, the ones that have lived 1,000 lives. You know what I mean?
Oh, yeah.
Like, you could not be more diametrically opposed in careers of a hardcore music artist or a decorated city councilor who is...
And he kind of explains how he balances that out, because obviously... The people in town know who he is. It's not like he's not like he's hiding it.
Right, right, right.
Yeah, he's got like 18 albums. He can't just not be that guy for a while. But it's a really interesting interview. It's all brought to you by Z&M Home Buyers. You can find it on Apple Podcasts, SoundCloud, Spotify, Google Podcasts, and rock102.com. Anyhow, so there is that. I'm really looking forward to tonight. Tonight's going to be very cool.
I'm excited to have you there. I can't wait to see Mark. I'm excited. I want to get off stage as fast as I can so I can actually just watch the show. Do you know what I mean?
Yeah. This is actually, is this right? Yeah, I think this is right. I think this would be our first comedy show since the pandemic.
Oh, really?
Yeah, because Jenny and I would go, you know, all the time. We'd go like, you know, if Bob Marley were playing at the Hoogie Lau. We'd go. Andy Yee set us up with tickets to see Kevin Hart at the Mullen Center.
That's cool.
We were like in the front. We had front row tickets.
How was the show?
It was good. It was really, really good.
Yeah.
His opener was better. Was funnier. And I wish I could remember the guy's name.
There's my life. I'm always the opener guy where people go, that guy was great.
Yeah.
What was his name again? I don't know. The first guy.
Yeah, we saw Donnell Rawlings at Roar.
Donnell's.
He was great.
One of my favorites.
He was great. He was awesome. You know, seen Ralphie one or two times.
Yeah,
absolute classic. Best. But we haven't been since the pandemic, and we've been meaning to come to Loft because, one, I'm thrilled you're doing it. Two, I've known you for a while.
Yeah.
And it's something that we like to do.
Well, I'll make sure as a practical joke I make everyone wear a mask. Just so you think you're teleported back to the pandemic times.
You got everybody separated 6 feet, yeah, and we all have to wash our hands with sanitizer.
You didn't go to any shows, any comedy shows during the pandemic?
No.
Those ones? Oh,
no.
They were fun.
I bet they were.
Oh, they were great. We're doing them outside. I did one on a farm. Where while we were on, I was with Vic DiBattista, while we were on stage, goats would just randomly come up on stage and start chewing our pant legs. did a couple of drive-in movie theater shows.
Oh, yeah.
Where you obviously can't hear people because they're in their car. So what they did was the first iteration of it was they told people, well, when you're laughing, hit your horn. Which sounds great in theory.
But it's not.
But when you hit a punchline, it's like, meh, 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 meh. And then like the one guy who really loves it is just, eh, for 5 minutes.
Yeah.
It's real annoying. So then the next time they said, flash your lights. So you're like, okay. So yeah. You hit a punchline and it's just like, you're like, I'm going to have a seizure. Like it's just like lights, silence, but lights were just in your face. I did a lot of shows. Like at these breweries in Connecticut for the Comedy Craft Brew
Tour.
I did those shows, but a lot of them were outside, you know, in a tent, on the back of a pickup truck. You know, they were wherever we could do. And then a lot of comedy on Zoom, which is just a disaster.
That has to be brutal.
Oh, the worst.
I mean, it's kind of like doing comedy in an empty room and getting no understanding of what the reaction is from anybody.
Oh, well, the worst is when
I believe they call that radio.
Yeah. The worst is when you could see their face, you know?
You're right. And everybody's on mute.
Terrible. I know Christine Blinn, who was a comedian very long time. She's super funny. We were doing one, and her father was on the Zoom, and he was in his underwear watching it in his Lazy Boy. I know he's so mad that I'm telling this right now on the air, but he had a, we'll just call it like a Janet Jackson-esque style underwear malfunction.
Oh, really?
When he got up. Yes.
Yeah.
Oh, he loved the show. He was having a ball. So,
like a Jeffrey Toobin moment?
Yes. Well, not
really enjoying the show?
No.
Was he Toobin on the video?
No, we'll just say he was having a ball. And it was a great show. And, Christine's face was horrified, but it made that was the most fun Zoom show I ever had of all the pandemic. Was that?
And now, Bax's View from the Couch, brought to you by Rocky's Ace Hardware, your grilling headquarters, Weber, Big Green Egg, Uni Pizza Ovens, and Traeger Wood Fired Grills.
Hey, good morning, sports fans. How the heck are you? Folks, remember yesterday when I handicapped the All-Star Game, predicting that the American League would pound the living snot out of the National League just like they've done every single year since 2013? Well, I certainly do. This is why I would strongly suggest to you that when it comes to gambling and sporting events, do not listen to a single word I say. Sure, I'm quick to dish out my opinions, but my opinions are often straight-up trash. Last night was one such example. You see, last night, the American League lost their first All-Star game in 10 years after Colorado's Elias Diaz jacked a two-run go-ahead home run in the eighth inning, the result of which gave the National League the win last night in Seattle, final score 3-2, thereby giving the illusion that the game included rare moments of excitement and drama. Now, I think most of us realize that because this was the mid-season classic, that the necessary components of actual excitement and drama are both relative. In my opinion, since this is a primarily meaningless exhibition with largely irrelevant set of incentives, everything must be put into perspective. Yes, the National League broke a 9-game All-Star losing streak. Now what? Well, because they've won the All-Star game, the National League will now have the home field advantage in the World Series. Which is great if you happen to be in the World Series. But since 14 out of the 15 teams in the National League aren't going anywhere near the World Series this year, I would find that to hardly be the reason why Elias Diaz of the last place Colorado Rockies was chosen as the All-Star MVP. No, sir, it's really all about the bonus that each player receives. And at only $5.5 million per season, I'm sure Diaz is looking to grab any extra cash he can get his hands on. Because when your team is 18 games out of first place, what the hell else is there to do? This is why words like excitement and drama really have no place in this situation. And if they do, it's only because something has gone terribly wrong. But hey, enough of my yapping. Sports brought to you by Rockies Ace Hardware. Bob at the Agawam Rockies is a man of steel. Steel chainsaws, steel blowers, steel trimmers. Bob is a steel train expert to show you why the orange and white is the only way to go. Good people like Bob and rock solid service at every Rockies Ace Hardware. I'm back. That's my view from the couch.
Rock 102, Springfield's classic rock.
Rock Rock 102, Springfield's Classic Rock at 7:11 and AC/DC with Bax and Nagel and Marty Caproni on Rock 102. I've never been arrested for committing a crime. I don't typically commit.
Not one ever?
No, I've never actually had the experience of being incarcerated for anything, really.
Never joined a cult and held someone down while you murdered them?
No, I never have.
Weird, me neither.
I mean, I feel like I've been in a man-made prison more than once in my life, but that was not a felony, or was it even a misdemeanor at that point?
Not sure what you're referring to, but okay.
I came across a story yesterday. I find it to be really interesting to me because, you know, I think when you reach a certain age, you know, I'll be 56 this year. You're in your 40s, right?
I am.
All right, you're in your 40s. At what point do you think you say, you know what, maybe crime I've outgrown? I mean, the criminal mind, I think, has a shelf life. If you haven't committed all your crimes by at least 35, you shouldn't even bother.
Well, what type of crimes are we talking about, though?
Well, let's just say like shoplifting, for example.
I feel like shoplifting, another thing I never did, I should change that. When I was 6 years old, I went to the Country Trading Post in Chicopee. And they used to have the penny candies, you know, and they had those little chocolate balls and a little thing, and they were a penny for the thing. And one of them had broken open, and the chocolate balls were in the bottom of the thing. So I reached in, and I put a couple in my mouth. And we walked out to the car. My mom goes, what do you got in your mouth? And I was like, what? And then and I ate it, and my mother goes, what was that? And I go, is this candy? And she goes, well, where'd you get that candy? I said, from school. My friend gave it to me. And she said, so if I call your friend's mother and ask if you got candy, would you? And I just collapsed. No, it was in the bottom of the thing, and I took it because it wasn't in the packaging. And my mother, to her credit, she gave me the penny, and she said, "You walk right back in there, and you go right up to Carl Roy, who owned the Country Trading Post, and you actually, I don't even think it was Carl. I think it was his father, Roger. You give him that penny, and you apologize to him." And I did. And the humiliation I felt in that moment, I was like, well, that's it for me with shoplifting. You
see?
Know?
Yeah.
And I feel like the latest that someone might do that would be like 12 or 13. Why? Do you have somebody that's older than that?
On Sunday, two mouth-breathing morons were at the pro shop at the Ferndown Forest Golf Club in Bournemouth, England.
Okay.
Right there in plain view of security cameras because, you know, pro shops are crawling with security cameras.
I think everything nowadays is crawling with security cameras. Even people's houses now.
I think if you run a business and you don't have video cameras surveilling every inch of your place, then shame on you. But this place had the cameras. And these two guys are seen on video grabbing a couple of putters at the pro shop. They walk up to this display, and one guy, and you know, they're working in cahoots. Both these guys know what they're doing, and they're working together. So this one guy pulls out a couple of putters, and they're behind another display of like T-shirts or whatever.
Yeah.
And the other, and the one guy who pulls the putters hands them to the other guy. And the other guy's standing with his back to the putters.
How do you steal a putter? It's not like you can throw it in your pocket.
No, he did the next best thing.
Oh.
He positioned himself in a way where the guy at the register could not see this.
Okay.
He stuck the putters down the length of his pant leg.
Oh my God.
And then tried to, limp out of the front door. And the employers the shop's employees were outside talking to another customer and watched the not so smooth criminals get into their van. They grabbed the license plate while these guys drove off, and with help of other golfers and authorities, they were quickly identified. Because you know, when you hang out on a golf course all day, you get to know a few people, and they were identified. Needless to say, it's neither the heist of the century, and these guys, I believe, were arrested. But this is, if you watch the video, it's hilarious.
How old do you think these guys are in the video? That's
I'm going to say.
Our age or older?
They're older. I'm going to say late 60s, maybe early 70s.
Oh, what garbage.
And the guy that's putting the guy that's putting the clubs down his pants could be not early 70s. I mean, the guy's like in an advanced age, certainly beyond the point of stealing stuff from the pro shop.
Well, the other thing I was going to say, if he's beyond 70 and he's got putters down his pants.
Yeah.
Everyone knows it's not just because he's happy to see them. They know it's putters down his pants.
Yeah, exactly. So so the question I'm asking is, at what age do you say crime is a young man's game?
Yeah.
You know, I'm at the point now where if I can eat pudding today, that's about as much as I want to do.
What a way to go out, right? You got 8 years left on the planet, maybe total? And your legacy is now going to be the guy who stole two putters?
I'm watching the video now. So the first guy, the guy that grabs the putters, is blocking this guy so that, you know, no one can possibly see what's happening here. But and the older guy, it almost looks like it could be a father and son.
Oh, that's even worse.
Like the dad is the older one, and the son is probably late 50s, early 60s, and the younger guy's wearing shorts, the old guy's wearing long pants like old guys always do, and they just walk out. And I'm just thinking, haven't you had enough? At 60, 70 years old, it's maybe just time to not be involved in this kind of criminal activity.
And I don't want to sound too judgmental. Let's say the guy was 70-something and they were stealing a walker or a wheelchair because they didn't have health insurance and the guy really needed it. You'd be like, I feel bad for that guy. I still shouldn't have done it, but I feel bad. You're stealing putters.
Yeah.
Completely non-essential items, complete luxury items. You're going to use them on a golf course, which I would assume means you have enough money to pay for a darn putter.
Right. But on the other hand, don't you feel some sympathy for the guy? Because clearly he's struggling with a short game.
That's terrible. They get what they... I would like to volunteer to be the reader of the eulogy, to write the eulogy for that gentleman.
How do you start that off?
I think what I do is I place two putters in the casket right off the bat. I come in, you needed these more than the rest of us.
Yeah,
you
know? Right. And any good golfer is like, these are knockoffs. These aren't even good putters. Right.
While I'm putting the putters in, though, I steal his watch, you know, just so he knows what it's like. What a terrible way. He's probably got grandkids.
Oh, yeah.
Can you imagine? Grandpa got arrested for...
I'm gonna guess that this is your grandpa, and this guy has not really settled down in criminal activity. That you're probably used to grandpa getting away with this kind of stuff all the time.
Yeah, he's teaching the kids family business.
Yeah,
I'll make one other caveat. That is to assume this guy doesn't have some form of dementia or something like that, where he's acting out now at this age or whatever. I have to say that because last week, Nagel and I were in here. You were on vacation. And there was a story about a woman in Boston who went hiking in the woods and was stuck in a swamp for 3 days.
Oh, I saw that story. Yeah.
And the two of us around here were like, who goes hiking and doesn't prepare? Who doesn't bring their cell phone? Who doesn't tell people they're going somewhere? We're just trashing this poor lady. And then we get done and the phone rings while we're on commercial break and it's Hawkman. And we answer the phone, and it's Hawkman and his mom, and they're like, we just want to let you know, it's not released in that article, but the lady was developmentally challenged. Steve and I are like, okay, coming back out of the commercial break to a really, really contrite apology. So I just make that caveat so it doesn't happen 2 weeks in a row.
Yeah.
But I just pulled up that video so I could see it. It looks as ridiculous as you said. I recommend people pull it up and look at it.
It's and the thing is, if the old guy were working alone in this crime, I'd say, okay, maybe there is a form of dementia going on. But there's two of them here. It's like they're both working in tandem to get away with this.
And one of them... the old man, to me, in this picture, looks kind of like Robert Kraft from the angle. And who does the other guy look like, if you take a look? Just look at the hair.
A little bit like a blonde Belichick, maybe?
No, he looks like Roger Goodell.
He does look like Roger Goodell.
Yeah, he looks like Roger Goodell.
Yeah, and just like Mr. Kraft, who has worked on his own putts a few times, so is this guy. You're right. He does look like a little bit of Roger Goodell on him.
Doesn't it?
Yeah. But
the worst criminals you've ever seen. That video is hilarious. I highly recommend it.
I'll have to share that on our
Facebook page.
On Facebook, if
that's
can.
Great.
But yeah, these guys look like a little real criminal. Ocean's 11. This isn't.
No. It's not even Ocean's 1.
Yeah, right. These are not geniuses we're talking about.
Wow.
It's 7:22. We're back. Rock 102, Springfield's Classic Rock. It's 7:27 and Steelers Wheel stuck in the middle with you with Bax and Nagel and Marty Caproni on Rock 102. The Rock 102 wing thing is coming up on August 13th, brought to you by Aqua Pump and Dave Minor Exterior Home Improvements. You can spend the afternoon at the beautiful Barney Estate at Forest Park and enjoy wings of all kinds. There's hors d'oeuvres. There's adult beverages. There's lots of wings. There's yard games. There's wings. Music from the Double Dose of Dave, and also a lot of wings. Tickets are on sale now at rock102.com, although I will tell you that this thing is selling out very, very quickly, and it will sell out. So if you haven't bought your tickets already, you might want to consider doing it right away. It's all tossed and sauced by Log Rolling Catering, Nor'easter Organic Life Hydroponics. It's Sunday, August 13th at the Barney Estate in Forest Park from Rock 102 Springfield Classic Rock.
I think I'm going to go to that.
Yeah, it's fun. It's a nice, quiet, chill day.
Here's a weird question. Do you have a go-to flavor of wings that you like?
Not necessarily. I mean, I'll eat any wing. I there's some I like better than others. I mean, I like a good old buffalo wing. I don't need it searing hot.
Right.
Yeah. I mean, the medium would be fine with me.
I can't do the searing. I have this thing where I sweat when I eat anything spicy.
Yeah.
If I have any type of like anything more than even with a medium wing, I'm sweating off my forehead. I sweat through napkins, paper towels, everything. It doesn't stop me because I'm a slob, but I do. But I have found a new flavor that I'm into.
What's that?
Sweet chili.
Sweet chili.
Yeah.
I have had that.
It's sweet chili with a little bit of ranch or blue cheese to dip.
Mm-hmm. And it's pretty good.
I'm just saying, I might go to the thing there.
I think if you held a gun to my head and said, "Tell me what your favorite wing is," and that scenario plays out all the time, all over the
time. I've heard numerous times where a guy just busts into the door with a gun. I need to know now.
Yeah, right. Give me your wallet. And what are your favorite kind of wings? It would be like a dry rub. I like a wing with just a dry rub. I don't need sauce. A dry wing with the rub.
We couldn't be more diametrically opposed in that.
You're not in on it?
I need sauce slobbering all over it.
Do you? Now do you use like the blue cheese as a beverage?
I don't order wings without getting extra dressing, and I don't just do blue cheese. I get ranch too.
You know, people turn their nose on the ranch, but when it comes to wings, it tastes perfectly fine. I prefer the more cheesy version.
You like what? Cheesy?
Yeah, like the blue cheese. I'd rather blue cheese than ranch.
I like the blue cheese with the buffalo. I like the ranch with the honey barbecue or a sweet chili.
And yet I don't see any wings in front of us right now.
I am so hungry right now because I have eaten exactly one sandwich since I last talked to you.
That's like a full day,
time.
24 hours. You've barely eaten in 24 hours.
Right. You know, who's the big sponsor we have right now that does wings? Is that the Hanger?
The Hanger does wings.
Well,
we're going to run a commercial for the 99. I mean, they've got wings too.
Wings, yeah.
And they're not bad over there.
And still no wings.
And still, I don't see anybody.
Kicking in the door at 7:30 in the morning with wings.
How many times have you and I...
talked about food?
No. Okay. How many times have you and I worked together when Steve is out? Is this the third time?
Third time.
Every time that's happened where it's you and me, we talk about food, nothing gets delivered.
Nothing.
But if you do something with Steve, all of a sudden, boom, food like that.
We were talking about corned beef, and we were reading an article who had the best corned beef, and there was a place right here in East Long Meadow.
Yeah.
And the guy just showed up here 10 minutes after we were talking about it. With a pile of an assortment, if you will, of Reubens and corned beef and egg sandwiches for breakfast.
Mm-hmm.
And I mean, just the food was amazing.
Yeah, yeah. Seeing.
And then you and I sitting here. And, of course, Steve doesn't want to eat it because he's busy on the Peloton now, losing all his weight, you know, trying to body shame us.
Sure.
And I'm just stuffing Reuben after Reuben down my gullet.
You got more
so happy.
You got like you could be Reuben Kincaid at that point.
And then you and I could sit on here and talk about food all day long.
All day.
It's a great topic. You'll never get me to not talk about food. I love it.
I'm with you on that one.
And no one cares.
If they did,
sad.
There would be a whole buffet of food right in front of us now.
Yeah, someone.
7:34. With Bax and Nagel and Marty Caproni on Rock 102, it's time for news brought to you by Gary Rome Hyundai. Go to Gary Rome Hyundai today and get 0% financing on select models. We've talked about it already this morning. Residents of the Pioneer Valley near the Connecticut River woke up Tuesday morning under a flood warning as Western Mass and its central waterway, the Connecticut River, and its tributaries experienced overruns on their banks and due to the on and off heavy rains that we've been receiving. In Massachusetts, the National Weather Service flood warning extended from the Vermont border all the way down to the Connecticut River to Holyoke. In Vermont, the situation is potentially life-threatening in some areas. The Weather Service's Burlington office says that the state had been under a flood warning and was under a flood warning or a more serious flood watch in certain areas. And in the Pioneer Valley, the Weather Service projected moderate flooding along the river from Greenfield to Holyoke. Even with the clearer skies in the forecast, warning was Tuesday, yesterday, and as well as today. Areas of the Deerfield River could also see minor flooding, and the Weather Service advised pedestrians to stay cautious when walking near riverbanks, urged drivers to avoid flooded roadways, and to not bypass barricades. So if you see a roadway shut down because of the flooding, and you think that you can pass it,
don't.
That's a big, big, fat, stinky mistake.
Don't be the guy in the, I just got a brand new Dodge Hemi and I paid $65,000 for it and it's jacked up and I can make it through this puddle. Don't be that guy.
Don't be that guy. And don't be the guy where, you know, rescue vehicles have to pull you out of a flowing river.
That's what I'm saying. You know what? Stay safe. Stay away from the river this weekend. You know, selfishly, you know, if you're looking for something to do. Doug Key will be at Loft Comedy Club Saturday night. It's my favorite. Honestly, this is probably the week to let it go. And boaters that I saw, all the boats were still in at the Oxbow, which was nice to see. But if you're thinking like, yeah, I'm going to get on the river. I was a lifelong boater. My parents, I grew up on a boat. It may seem like, yeah, you're fine. You're out there. But what's under those water that you can't see because it's so murky are submerged trees that are, you know, waterlogged, so they're like 1 or 2 foot below the surface. Very quickly, you could find yourself spending a lot of money, or even worse, if you hit something like that.
In Vermont, where you were last night, heavy rains had just pounded the state. Rising waterways washed out some roads, inundated riverfront communities, including the state capital of Montpelier. Floods forced the closure of some 36 Vermont state roads and many more local roads. Multiple miles along Interstate 89 in Montpelier, where it was closed last Monday night for flooded highways. Okemo Mountain, pretty heavily damaged as a result of the floods and mudslides and a lot of other things. They got hit pretty hard too.
Rough, real rough. And like I said, even 91 along that, there was you saw them doing repairs where there were landslides that took out parts of the guardrails and stuff like that. So, both those areas, either side of the Connecticut River there, New Hampshire, Vermont.
Preparations were made ahead of time to ensure that in Holyoke, that the dam could handle the impact brought by the rising conditions in water and the water levels causing flooding concerns in part of Hamden and Hampshire counties. And according to the National Weather Service there, areas are categorized at the flood stage when water reaches 9 feet. The Connecticut River at Holyoke was just shy of that at 8.8 feet as of 2 o'clock yesterday afternoon.
Well, they got some rain up there yesterday, so let's hope that that doesn't affect down. I don't know how that works. Do you know how that works? Does it take like a day for that water to come down the river, or you said it already crested?
The Oxbow crested yesterday.
Okay.
And flooded out part of Route 5, which was closed in both directions, and they were going to reassess that this morning. I don't know if they've done that yet. But as of yesterday, as of last night, they said that they would be shutting it down until further notice.
Jeez.
And that, you know, today was going to be the day they'd look at it and see if they could reopen it. But they, but you know, it had motorists were advised to avoid the area, you know, the Oxbow, you know, there were some people told to stay out of the water. Same thing with the Brunels.
Yep.
Up the river, they had, you know, water, chunks of parking lot and wood and debris were flowing down the river at the time because, you know, there's so much being damaged that it's coming down here. If you got a boat in the river down there, it could easily be damaged by something that came from Vermont.
Yeah, well, that's one of the real legitimate concerns. And I, like I told you, on side of those roads, you know, New Hampshire, Vermont, they always have these stone cliffs, and normally it's a trickle going down.
Yeah,
it's a full on waterfall, and you can see foliage and trees and stuff and rocks and mud at the bottom. It's not good. Not good scene.
Brunel's Facebook page said they'll be working to restore all the docks as soon as it's safe to do so. Like I said, some did get damaged yesterday. They're asking for people to stay away from the marina.
Yeah.
Today, probably a good piece of advice.
Yeah, I would say.
45 beautiful acres of sweet corn, green peppers, and other crops at Arcadia Wildlife Sanctuary in Northampton were scheduled to be picked Tuesday, but unfortunately, because the Connecticut River was still rising and not expected to crest until Tuesday or Wednesday morning, they're in danger of losing a lot of their crops. Farms across Western Mass, Vermont, Pennsylvania, New Jersey, and New York are looking anywhere between $3 to $5 billion in damage to rural communities, hardest hit. They're likening the damage to Hurricane Irene back in 2011, which was awful back then, if you recall. So not so good.
That's no bueno.
Springfield has confirmed that the city saw 16 homicides after a fatal shooting outside 39 Commonwealth Avenue on July 7th. They are now confirming that was a homicide. Officers located both subjects involved in the incident, including an adult male suffering from the gunshot wound. He was rushed to Bay State, where he later died. 16 homicides in this year alone, which is a lot.
What do we usually do? What's Springfield's normal homicide number?
I don't know why I'm thinking this. I'm trying to remember what the highest number was. I think the highest number was in the 20s.
Oh, so we're on pace for a record year here, Springfield.
Well, the way we're working now, I mean, you know, we are over the hump. We got a whole other, you know, 5.5 months to
halfway
go.
Halfway there, we're trending to break the record.
Yeah, I mean, I'm not suggesting that we start to ramp up our game here, but you know, the numbers are not real great. To be quite honest with you,
that's a tough thing because who do you blame for that? You know, you can't blame the policing. You can't blame, you know, who do you blame for?
Well, you know, I think if you ask the police and if you ask the mayor,
yeah,
what's the problem? What's going on here? They immediately would point their finger at the bail system in Massachusetts being a reason why you're having so many violent offenders come back out on the street, feel emboldened that they can get away with nearly anything because, you know, no system available in Massachusetts is going to hold them. They're just going to get released while they await their trials on previous charges, that they go out and commit bigger, more substantially violent, you know, violent crimes. And that's what is fueling a good deal of this.
That's one of those things that it seems like a story that never ends every time you look at it and they're like, oh, this guy skipped bail. This guy was out on bail. This guy violated his probation. This guy, and they're all like violent criminals and everything else, but there's no accountability in our court system here for how they get, how that happens.
Well, my understanding is the way bail works in Massachusetts. And again, not having been through the bail system myself, I don't know this for sure. But the idea of bail is to ensure that you'll show up to court.
Right.
And I understand that. But if you've got a guy who has committed a violent crime, putting him back out into society while he awaits his trial is not helping anybody. You know, the cops are rearresting people constantly over and over and over again.
Right.
And these people just realize, hey, listen, you know, I'm I'm just going to be released again. I'll be on bail in no time at all.
And I got to be honest, too. Like, if you know, you're a good cop, we'll say, right? And you're just out there and you're looking at the way your day is going. Half the public hates you just because you're wearing a badge, right?
Mm-hmm.
And you're catching flack from everybody. Half the people have a camera in your face on their phone trying to get you to do something wrong so they can post it on YouTube and monetize it, right? And then you do make a good bust, and you see that guy walking down the street a week later. You got to be honest, man. As a cop, I'm only human. I'm probably like, well, you know what I'm going to do? I'm going to sit right here in my cruiser. I'm going to ride out the rest of this thing and get my retirement and go off into the sunset.
It's got to be the toughest job in the world is to be a cop. And to be a cop in Springfield where, or in Massachusetts, because it's not just Massachusetts. Yep. You're going to have the same problem in you know, other cities. Some right. are much, much worse than Springfield. Right. Lawrence, Brockton, parts of Boston.
Sure.
I would say Worcester. I wouldn't want to be a cop in Worcester.
And
I wouldn't even want to be a resident of Worcester.
That's not to say that I'm not sensitive to the fact that there's definitely, you know, corrupt cops out there, and there's definitely, you know, there's definitely been the challenges. But one of the things that always bothers me is you see these, like, you'll see a police shooting somewhere, and then all the cops catch flack no matter where they are in the country.
Yep.
But, like, 80% of those shootings that you see, like, the really, the ones that are really over the top, that there's no question about it, like, it's like a cop shooting a guy in the back or whatever. They're usually in these, like, real down south states where they're like, would you like to be a cop? Yeah, my daddy and my daddy's daddy was a cop, so mm-hmm. I'm a cop. And there's no real training, you know what I mean?
Right.
Up here, at least they're trained. They have to have a degree, or at least, you know, we reward them for having advanced degrees and everything else.
Well, I mean, we have, you know, we hold cops to a certain standard.
Right.
You know, a certain level of expectation that they're going to behave in a certain way right. when situations arrive. But in the moment, in the heat of something being committed, when things get escalated, you know, it doesn't excuse a cop when he misbehaves.
No.
But on the other hand, there's a part of you that thinks, I've just arrested this guy 9 times and he's right. back out. And if I arrest him again, 10, 11 for the 12th time, he's going to come out again.
Right.
And just be given more confidence that he can commit any crime he wants to.
Right.
If I'm a cop and I'm seeing that every day, I'm not saying it's justified right. to act in an inappropriate, dangerous way,
well,
but there's a part of me who said, how would I act any differently?
I 100% agree.
And you know, I'm not a violent guy. In fact, yeah. I, you know, when push comes to shove, I'm the first cowardly lion in the room. believe you me, when I'm a floundering coward and when things get rough, but, in that situation, do I really think that I would act any differently if my frustration over what I'm doing, you know, is such where I'm doing the best I can to take crime off the street and here it comes back 2 days later after making bail?
Right. Why am I bothering making the bust again, risking my life that this time when I make the bust, the guy's going to have a knife or a gun?
Yeah.
You know what I mean? I always,
it's total morale killer.
I feel like I can do a lot of jobs if I put my mind to it. I don't think I could be a cop because I don't think I have the temperament, because I watch these YouTube videos of the kids.
Mm-hmm.
I've said this before, and the kids are like, am I being detained or am I not being detained, officer? I am a sovereign citizen. You got no right to stop me. Let me talk to your supervisor. The way they talk. And I was like, the first day as a cop that they go, okay, Marty, you're on your own. We're taking your field training officer out. Here's your patrol car call. I'm like, the first kid I pull over, he's like, am I being detained or am I not? I'm like, clackety, clackety, clack. I'm just tasing him up, dragging him in, throwing him into jail. So I'm like, that's the 15th kid Marty's tased today. I'm going to keep lighting these kids up until they stop running their mouths.
It's
the
tased of Caproni Festival.
Yeah, right, right.
I have as much business being a cop as I have business being an underwear model. I mean, that's the way I see it.
Yeah, I think you'd look good in a nice pair of underwear.
No, I wouldn't. I really wouldn't. truly would not be my my finest moment.
Firefighter, I could do that one all day long. I could do that one. And I'm not crapping on you firefighters. All of my friends are firefighters, most of them in Chicopee. I always joke around. I go, their contract's so great. They work like 2 days on with like 5 days off. Is it a career or is it a sleepover with your friends? Someone's making chili. Right,
but those 2 days, there's one making chili. Those 2 days, you're working your ass off.
The thing that you see with firefighters or with cops is, yeah, there's a lot of downtime in that job and there's a lot of perks at that job. But what we're paying you for is that 0.05% of the time where everybody else is running in the opposite direction and you have to run, you know what I'm saying, towards whatever's the fire or towards the kid. That's when you could not pay me all the money in the world to be either one of those.
No, I don't think I could do it either.
No.
And I applaud someone who can do it, get through a career, retire honorably, and live their life. God bless you for being able to do it. I know I don't have the temperament for it. And I know that if placed in that position where the frustration is constantly running high and there's a million eyes and scrutiny and video cameras on me at all times, including body cams, that would be almost an impossible job to do.
Really?
It really would. And again, I applaud anyone who wants to go into law enforcement. It's a job that we absolutely need. But you know, there needs to be changes in how this state operates so that cops can do their job and get crime off the street, and we can all feel safer. So we're not looking at 16 homicides in 7 months.
And I'll be honest, most of my interactions with police have been very pleasant because I try to extend respect. One of my family members was a police officer. He said, hey, if you get pulled over, understand when I'm walking up to your car, I am on edge because I want to make it home to my wife and kid. So if you have a chance, get your window down enough, put your interior light on if it's nighttime, turn your radio off, turn the ignition off, put your keys up on the dash, put both hands on the wheel where you can see them. If you already have your registration stuff available, have it out. If you have to reach for it, don't be fiddling around for it when I'm walking up to the car. That's what I follow. I have my hands on the wheel, and when they come up, it's yes officer, no officer, or yes trooper, no trooper. And a lot of times by extending that courtesy to the police officer, they will extend you courtesy back, you know?
I tend to break down in tears.
Yeah, that's a good move, too.
it hasn't helped, but I...
Sometimes defecate yourself and just be like, I was just trying to get home.
I just need to use the toilet, sir. It's 7:51. Your Pioneer Valley forecast looking like this today. It's sunny to partly cloudy, a high of 91. Tomorrow, overcast, a stray shower, and a thunderstorm is possible with a high of 89. It's currently, 73 on Rock 102.
Connecticut and Massachusetts, Z&M Homes buys.
Rock 102, Springfield's Classic Rock, 7:57 and Queen. With Bax and Nagel and Marty Caproni on Rock 102. It's going to be a decent day today. Hot again. Sunny and partly cloudy with a high of 91. Tomorrow, overcast. There's a possibility of a stray shower or a thunderstorm. But, you know, we really could use the rain with a high of 89. It's 67 degrees right now in downtown Springfield. Big show tonight. I'm looking forward to it. I haven't seen the live comedy in a damn long time. I'm looking really forward to it.
Well, once you get by my set, you're gonna enjoy some really great comedy.
Listen, I've seen your work.
You've seen me bomb.
I have seen you at the highest level, and I have seen you do something that looked like comedy, only without the noise and joy.
My favorite was that you came up, and we talk about it often. I got to get you back on stage. You came up, and you're like, I can't really do it. And then you killed for like 15 minutes, and I was like, look at this guy. He just dusted it off after 20 years and did 10 times better than me.
With absolutely no material. By the way, that will not happen tonight, so don't even think about
it. You sure?
Yeah, no. Not for that ticket price, I'm not.
It's bad enough they're getting me.
Yeah,
you know?
Right. Listen, don't do that. But live comedy is one of those things that I've always really enjoyed and always really loved. Had a real
Mark Norman
passion
is,
for him. He's awesome.
He's very good at it. He's really really good at it. And it's gonna be an awesome night. There are still tickets available for tonight and both shows and tomorrow's late show, Thursday's late show. So go to loftcomedyclub.com now. Get your tickets. Get your friends. Come on out and enjoy the show.
It's 7:59 at Rock 102. Live.
The following takes place between 8 a.m. and 9 a.m. And now, Bax's View from the Couch, brought to you by Rocky's Ace Hardware, your grilling headquarters, Weber, Big Green Egg, Uni Pizza Ovens, and Traeger Wood Fired Grills.
Hey, good morning, sports fans. How the heck are you? Hey, not to make anybody jealous, but in my house, I currently have a beautiful 42-inch flat-screen TV with high-definition picture quality, loads of pixels, and color that's as sharp and as vibrant as opening up a window and looking around. And while I'm sure that me and the missus are the envy of everybody in my neighborhood, the New England Patriots have now got me thinking about making an upgrade. The next time you find yourself going to Gillette Stadium for a Patriots home game, you will no doubt notice that they've made some improvements to the old joint. And among those improvements include the brand new 22,200-square-foot video monitor that's been placed in the end zone. Yesterday, the Patriots revealed pictures of the new video screen, which is not only five times the size of the screen that'll be replacing, it also happens to be the largest outdoor video board in the country. The surface covers approximately a full half acre of space and will give you a mind-blowing picture that includes a reported 20 million pixels. How many pixels does my TV have? Six. Now, as I'm reading about this yesterday, I cannot help but think that even though the stadium is looking at more than $250 million in upgrades and improvements, including a 360-degree observation deck and a 218-foot-tall lighthouse, you know, to bring the fishing boat safely to the shores of Foxborough, I cannot help but think that perhaps my living room might not be big enough for a 22,000-square-foot TV. I'm also thinking that this thing is going to require an enormous remote control, which of course will get lost every 3 days in between the cushions of the couch. The biggest problem with this thing is no matter how wide or how clear the picture might be, it still won't make the Patriots look any better, especially during that tough divisional schedule. Because if they play like they did last season, you're going to have 65,000 fans begging for Mr. Kraft to change the channel. But hey, never mind yapping, sports brought to you by Rocky's Ace Hardware, the Eagle battery-powered trimmer and blower, battery and charger included, now $229 at Rocky's with your Ace Rewards card. You're saving almost $100. I'm looking at that at the Rocky's app, and you can pick up the flyer in the store. What's on sale at Rocky's? It's always at your fingertips. I'm back, that's my view from the couch.
Rock 102, Springfield's classic rock.
Rock 102, Springfield's classic rock. It's 8:13 in Boston with Bax and Nagel and Marty Caproni on Rock 102.
Whew, home stretch.
Yeah.
Home stretch. Hanging in there.
You know, for a guy, I got to tell you, for a guy who's gotten no sleep, you're hanging in there pretty good.
I'm trying my best.
I don't know.
Jacked up on coffee, iced tea, whatever I have.
Jolt Cola. Remember that stuff?
Oh, my God.
Remember Jolt?
I remember Jolt Cola had triple the caffeine of a cup of coffee or whatever.
Yeah, twice the sugar, triple the caffeine.
Yeah.
I learned an entire semester of British literature on Jolt Cola and no-dose.
You know, people don't give it enough credit ahead of its time because that was really the original energy drink before 5-hour energy and before all this other stuff.
It didn't taste that good. It was like ridiculously sweet, but man, it did its business.
It absolutely did.
So, you know, we've, I don't know if anyone's really noticed, but when Marty and I get together, we tend to talk about food quite a lot.
One of my favorite things.
It probably is my favorite thing in the world, food.
And then I get letters from people after, or not letters, but, you know, messages on my Facebook and my Instagram, which people should follow, by the way. I get those, and people send me messages like, I hate you. You made me hungry. I ate a steak at 10:30 in the morning because of you, you know?
It's not our fault.
No, I was like, you know.
Yeah, what are you going to do?
Yeah, what are you going to say? If we're going to talk about food again, just for a second.
Well, there was this woman in Worcester.
Oh, well, all right, we can talk. Yes.
Yeah, let's start off with that.
Sure.
Because I got a thing here.
I don't need to, I'm not going to pull up the article and read her name and everything. I'm just going to give you the gist of the article.
All right.
I was reading it this morning and I started howling laughing when I read it because it was about this woman who just won a restaurant challenge that was very hard to do. She ate 4 pounds of meat, cheese, and pasta. In one sitting at this restaurant.
Okay.
The meat consisted of a lasagna, chicken parm, eggplant parm, a cantaloupe-sized meatball, sausage, bacon, pasta and red sauce. And they interviewed her, and the first quote in the article was her saying, "Yeah, well, I'm a little bit of a foodie." And I was thinking to myself, lady, that's not a foodie. That's a glutton. A foodie is somebody who has like a did you try this one little piece of black sea bass that has a flour on top of it and it's seasoned this way? And it's not enough to fill you up, you know? A foodie isn't 4 pounds of food.
This is Miss Pac-Man eating pills and ghosts.
Right.
That's
right,
what this is.
Right, right.
There's something about, I don't know what it is. There's something about competitive eating that I find so damn fascinating. I know a lot of people say, oh, that's so gross and disgusting. No. No, it is not. Get that idea out of your head right now. This I find to be like, you know, like man overcoming some of the most incredible obstacles in the world. You know, when Joey Chestnut's come to the Big E and packed down, you know, 60 hot dogs in a single sitting.
Right.
You know, that's amazing to me. I watch that guy, like, you know, he's got every major competitive food crown of the world, that, and it keeps going on.
That guy's so incredible. I was watching a clip of him. He was stuffing hot dogs down his gullet, and someone charged the stage. He actually headlocked the guy, threw him to the side, and continued to
eat the hot dog.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That's a true professional right there.
That's the greatest American hero.
Here's the question for you.
Yes.
Do you find competitive eating to be a sport?
If I'm going to consider horse racing and auto racing a sport, then yes.
Perfect. Perfect. I'm with you. Rodeo is another one.
Yep. It's still a competition. It requires a certain amount of training, and regardless of what it does to your body, you still do it because of your competitive drive.
I mean, the rodeo stuff, they're on a bull for 8 seconds, right? Yeah. So maybe I'm simplifying this and someone's going to get upset, but these competitive eaters, the amount of conditioning it goes into, they stretch their stomach by eating lettuce all, you know, leading up to their contest and everything else. Like the amount of dedication and the amount of fortitude it takes to push through, not throwing up all over yourself.
Right.
While you're just jamming food down your throat.
See, there's two different kinds of competitive eaters. You got a guy like Kobayashi or Joey Chestnut, where it's not just about the amount, but also about the speed in which they're eating this food.
Correct.
There's another form of competitive eating, which is amazing to me. And whenever I see like a TikTok video, I'll watch it all the way through, or I'll scroll over to see, well, did he finish it?
Is it the food challenges? Is that what it is?
There's like, these food challenges. And it's like certain restaurants will have a food challenge that if you can eat it, you get it for free and your name gets on a plaque.
Right.
There's this guy named Randy Santel, originally from St. Louis. I thought he was Canadian. He's from St. Louis.
Okay.
Guy travels all over the world, like literally all over the world, doing these restaurant challenges. So he'll eat like a 10-pound, you know, cheeseburger with fries and like a milkshake, and he has like an hour to finish it.
I'm already in. I'm already fascinated.
And he'll knock it down because it's, you know, that's easy for him. But what he also does, and I think this is smart because it shows that, you know, one, you know, sometimes the food wins. He'll even show the videos of him where he can't finish it.
That's awesome.
Wait, like he ran out of time, like he's got like a half hour to eat something or an hour, and he can't do it.
Yeah.
But then what he does is he'll go back and try it again.
Well, that's
insane. He'll say, I think it was like one where he says, I've been unable to do this twice. This is my third time.
To me, that's gold. I'd watch that all day.
All day.
Now you're invested. You have a storyline almost.
Yeah.
A trilogy, if you will.
You know, and some of the food is not anything you'd want to put in your system.
No.
You know, just by the sheer enormity of it.
I am fascinated by that the same way that you are. I do know, and I apologize because I don't have the article in front of me, but maybe it was last week with Nagel, I learned that the number two ranked competitive eater in the country is right here from Massachusetts, almost Western Mass, lives in Oxford. And I want to say his last name was Esper, but I don't know. My memory isn't working that well.
Really?
On 1 hour of sleep. Yeah, he was from Oxford, Massachusetts. And, you look at the guy, and I'm expecting the guy to look like me, but he doesn't. He's like in shape. He's like an athlete. He's in shape, and he's out there eating.
You know, that is the thing that people do not understand, that it's never the fat guy.
No.
The fat guy can't eat that much because I don't think his metabolism will allow him.
Wait, did you just call me fat like in a roundabout?
No, I'm speaking more generically. I'm speaking of the universal fat person.
Okay, yes. Not the one in front of you. I mean,
I mean, when Joey Chestnut holds the record for 76 hot dogs in 10 minutes.
Yeah.
That guy's pretty thin.
Yeah.
I mean, he works out.
Well, you got to if you're going to do that, right? Otherwise, you're going to have a heart attack. 62 hot dogs?
You got to have a heart attack. You also have to, at some point, digest it through. So there, you know, there's also the other part of the training you never see.
Ugh, that just makes me think back to the effluent in the river. That's all that does. By the way, the turd cast for today, a heavy.
George Esper is the guy I think you're talking about.
See that? I remember the last name a week later on like 2 hours of sleep.
Let's see. The Eater Press rankings. Yeah, he's Oxford, Massachusetts, number two.
Look at this.
In the I don't know if it's the in the major league eating world, he is number two.
So, you know, that's pretty good recall for being as tired as I am right now.
Well, you know what? I got to tell you, you know, it's nice to see there's someone from the New England area who is excelling in this kind of thing. Nearly everybody on this list of the top 30 is thin. There's a couple of exceptions. Eric Badlands Booker out of Selden, New York.
Ooh.
Little stocky. But everybody else looks like they're in great physical shape.
You know what? It's probably too late to do it. But if anyone upstairs was listening, how cool would it be to use that wing thing that we're at Forest Park and have a... you know what I mean? Have one that we could watch live.
That's a certain level of liability that I don't think we want to pay for anymore, because we've done those before.
Really?
Oh, yeah. We've done those wing eating contests.
I think there was one of those. You know what? I guarantee they wouldn't do it, because I remember reading about this. This might have even been when I was in college. There was a radio station that did a drink as much water as you can contest.
Oh,
You won like a whatever, and the woman overhydrated and died.
Yeah.
And they got sued for a lot of money. So
the grand prize was a Wii.
Yeah, that's what it was. Yeah. The Nintendo Wii, when it was like the hottest prize, the hottest game system in the country or something like that, right? Yeah.
And she died.
Imagine another, what a stupid way to go.
Do you ever go to a restaurant where you get your name on a wall for eating something? Because I have.
Did you get your name on the wall?
I got my name on a wall.
What did you eat?
It was in Illinois. And it was their hottest chili.
Oh,
and if you can eat their hot bowl of chili, a place called Den Chili. If you can eat the Den Chili, you got your name on a wall.
Did you?
I ate it, and yet, to be honest, I didn't think it was that hot. I think it was just they called it really hot to scare everybody.
Yeah.
But the fact of the matter is it wasn't that overwhelming. And so I packed that down in no time at all, and I got my name on a wall.
How was passing it later?
No problem.
Really?
Not. I've got somewhat of an iron constitution for certain foods.
Okay.
No problem at all. It almost felt like kind of anticlimactic. I expected it to be like I could have breathed fire after something like this. And my backside was going to look like a Bunsen burner, but it didn't.
Well, I told you I'm sensitive to spicy food.
Yeah.
But I also am very prone to being challenged and bet. And I am very much motivated when someone says, you can't do that. Hey, if you do that, I'll give you $100 or whatever. I was at the Hukilau, the great Hukilau, Chicopee Institution, when they had the little sushi bar off on the side there. And I was sitting there, and there was a group of my friends there. And one of them, Adam, my buddy Adam, was sitting there. And Adam is very successful. And we were talking about my lack of... ability to eat like sushi. I hadn't really eaten a lot of sushi, and my inability to eat spicy food. And he asked the chef to roll up a ball of wasabi, a little bit bigger than a golf ball, a little bit smaller than a tennis ball, and threw down $100. My other friends threw down $50. There's like $300 on the table, and they said, if you can eat the whole thing.
And how'd that go?
I swallowed it whole, which is the only saving grace I had. I threw it down. I was drinking a gin and tonic at the time. I threw it, washed it down with one gin and tonic, and I was like, this is great. That is the easiest money I ever had. And then my stomach started to be like, rah, 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 rah. And we were out somewhere, and I was like, oh no, oh no, oh no.
So that delayed reaction.
Yeah, yeah. So I candidly, one of my friends was chatting up a girl who was a nurse, and I candidly asked her on the side, I just ate a racquetball-sized ball of wasabi. And she's like, what? Why? Why? Because I'm an idiot. That's not important right now. What can I do to stop this from burning a hole in my stomach? She's like, bread. You got to eat bread.
Bread and milk.
I think we were downtown by this point. I went up to the hot dog guy downtown, and I was like, I'll give you $5 for as many rolls as you could give me. You want the hot dog? No, I just want the rolls. And he looked at me like, all right, crazy guy. Here's five rolls.
But you survived. There you go.
I survived.
It's 8:26 with Bax and Nagel and Marty. You know what I would love to do?
What's that?
This is going to sound so crazy. I mean, it's like, we're talking about competitive eating. I've always had Mykonos, which is moving out of the Eastfield Mall on Friday.
Yeah.
Friday's their last day.
Chris the Greek.
Yeah, Chris is moving it downtown on Main Street. So that's good. I wish him nothing but the best. But I've always had this fantasy of grabbing that rotating thing of gyros meat and just eating it Kobayashi style, like it's a giant cob of corn. Just chomped right down on it.
I
always thought that'd be awesome.
I believe in you. I think you could probably do that. That meat is so delicious.
It's so good. Yes.
But it's like one of those things that you have to be in the mood for too, though. Like you'd really have to have not eaten some Greek food for a while before you're like, I'll take down a 7 pound.
There's always room for Greek food. room.
This brings me to a thing that I forgot to say before, which is, if anybody knows of any local restaurants that have food challenges, shoot me a message there on Instagram or Facebook or whatever.
Yeah,
Marty Caproni. Just shoot me a message and let me know what it is, what the challenge is, where it is, and what the reward is.
I would like to see the assessment of that. You know, because there's restaurants all over the world that are doing these food challenges.
Right.
I don't know if anybody is doing one.
That's what I was thinking. I don't know if there's a restaurant doing it locally, and I think there should. I think the last one I heard of is one of my old favorite wings. We were talking about wing spots. Was Quickie's Wings in Chicopee. I don't know if it was their challenge, but I remember my brother, when my parents had him in charge of watching me and they went away for the weekend, my brother said that he and his friends would get me a six-pack of beer and leave me alone in the house for the weekend if I would eat one Quickie's dead on arrival wing and not drink milk or eat anything else for 5 minutes.
That's a good challenge.
It was a great weekend. I really enjoyed the six pack of beer, pouring it over my blistered lips. all my friends.
But I bet that first sip of that first beer must have felt so good going down.
Delish.
I bet. The only competitive challenge that I recall, and this goes back, I think Gus and Paul's had a it was either corned beef sandwich or a pastrami sandwich. It may have been pastrami.
Oof.
I would have ripped that to shreds.
Oh.
I would have done that all day long.
Oh,
Gordy was a friend of mine. Yeah, it still is a friend of mine. I would have loved to have done that.
You could have put him right out of business.
Oh, I would have chowed down all day. Yeah. Absolutely.
I'm so hungry right now. I'm so hungry.
We got news coming up next to Rock 102.
Winter can be brutal on your car. Summer can be just as bad. Overheated engine, tire pressure spikes, battery ready to boil. And the oil? Oh, man, get the oil changed. Or at least checked. Better go see Joe and the boys at
8:34. With Bax and Nagel and Marty Caproni on Rock 102, it's time for news brought to you by Big Y. Your family market. Sign up today and save with a My Big Y digital account. It's more than food. It's My Big Y. Visit your local Big Y today. Leslie Van Houten, one of the Charles Manson's followers, the former homecoming princess who at 19 helped carry out some of the most shocking and disgusting killings in American history, including against a wealthy Los Angeles couple at the direction of Charles Manson. After serving more than 50 years of a life sentence, was released yesterday. She's now 73 years old, released to parole supervision. That's according to the California Department of Corrections and Rehabilitation. She left the California Institution for Women in Corona, east of Los Angeles, early in the morning and was driven to a transitional housing facility. That's according to her attorney. Days earlier, Governor Gavin Newsom announced that he would not fight a state appeals court ruling that Van Houten should be granted parole. And he said it was unlikely the state Supreme Court would consider an appeal. The 1969 slayings and subsequent trials captivated the nation while the country was going through so many different changes, the Vietnam War, the civil rights movement, the assassinations of Martin Luther King and Robert Kennedy, and then this. So in spite of her involvement in some of the most gruesome murders ever, she's now walking out of there with her head held high at 73 years old, where she hasn't seen the light of day since she was 19. That's crazy to me.
She's 73.
You know, I mean, I realize she was eligible for parole. Yeah. She was denied it countless times as an accessory to murder or, you know, whatever. 50 years of a life sentence. You're walking out at 73. You know, at that age, I'd almost say, you know what? I might just be better off on the inside.
What do you think the odds are she kills somebody at a dispute at bingo night? You know what I mean? Something like that.
Like bludgeon somebody with a dauber?
Yeah.
I don't know. I mean, I don't know. I would think at 73, you probably don't act as violently as you did back in your, you know, carefree days of 19 or 20.
Yeah. Well, I got to be honest. I you know, when I pulled it up, there was a picture of her in her youth. I don't know. It wasn't a mugshot. Maybe it was. She was a very attractive woman.
Listen, for a woman who's been in prison for 50 years, at the age of 73, she's still, still a very handsome, stout woman.
Yeah, you know, I mean, if you're 73 and you're out there looking for love, I think, you know, things get picking. Maybe you decide, yeah, maybe I'll take a cult serial killer. You know, she. I think the reason she got that leniency, though, is because she just looks like an innocent. She looks like an innocent mom that's part of a bridge club.
Yeah, except, you know, I don't know if any of the members of the parole board were even alive.
No,
back
probably not.
In 1969. And or even remember much of the details of, you know, Shannon Tate getting killed or, you know, Wojtek Frykowski or any of the others that were, you know, savagely disemboweled to death.
So before my time, so she's been literally in prison since before I was born. Which is crazy to me to try to imagine that's what someone's done with their entire life in that time. Do you remember at all when the Manson killings happened or no?
So I would have been 3.
Oh, okay.
And my earliest, my only memory from 1969 was the moon landing. I remember that because that, you know, a 3-year-old can understand the moon.
Yeah.
You can understand being on the moon.
Yeah.
You can't really understand, you know, killing the pregnant wife of a film director.
No. Yeah,
that is a little too cerebral for a 3-year-old.
Fair point.
Yeah. But, you know, but ever since that point, the whole Manson family story, every bit of it, it's been a part of the culture, been part of the American lore. Like, how could this craziness have gone on for as long as it did?
This is like one of those things that, like, where I'm an idiot because I know about the Manson killings. I know the name Sharon Tate or whatever it was. I know all that. I did know that I think she was the pregnant one, right, that was killed.
Yes.
But I know no other details. You had said one gruesome detail off the air and I was like, that really happened?
Yeah. One of the guys was disemboweled with a chainsaw.
Ouch.
50 years later, she's walking the streets.
Kind of goes back to the DOA wings with my brother. I was disemboweled with a DOA.
Yeah, wing. I don't think it's quite the same.
No, not the same. All right.
Not quite the same. But, you know, I mean, if a Roman Polanski were allowed in this country, I'm sure he would have spoken up about this and say, hey, you know, maybe she should stay in.
So they let her go. She's 73. She obviously has no Social Security, right, because she hasn't paid into the system.
I don't think she's got enough quarters,
right,
to get anything out of this.
So what does she do for the rest of her life? Let's assume she lives to 85. She's got 12 years left. What do you do?
I other than going on welfare and continue to have the state of California pay for your care, I can't imagine what she does.
Well, then shout out to Governor Gavin Newsom for not appealing that parole thing.
You know, I don't know if you ever read the book Helter Skelter.
So my parents had it in the house.
Yeah.
But I picked it up, and I don't like really unpleasant things, especially when I was younger. Now I can handle them better.
Yeah.
I just wanted to be all unicorns and rainbow butterflies. So I remember reading like the first like few chapters and being like, ugh, and just putting it down.
Yeah. No, it's gross when you get right down to all the nitty gritty and all the good details. So, and when you consider the enormity of the story at the time, it's any wonder that any one of them would have gotten out. And if I were Leslie Van Houten, and I'm not, I would almost at 73, I'd say there's nothing for me.
Right, out, leave me
out
in.
There's nothing for me out here. I'm better off at this point in my life just staying in, because I have no real ability to kind of conform to a society I've not been a part of for 50 years.
Right. And all of your relatives that probably did, you know, give a dang about you are probably all dead. Right? You're 70-something.
Yeah.
So your mom's probably dead.
Parents are gone.
Aunts and uncles are dead.
Charlie Manson's no longer around to vouch for your character. You don't have any of that stuff.
Yeah, you don't have any family left, whether it's yours or Manson's.
Residents in the Pioneer Valley are dealing with a lot of flooding, or the potential of flooding. Pioneer Valley near the Connecticut River. People woke up yesterday morning under a flood warning as Western Mass Central Waterway is overrunning their banks after days of on and off heavy rain. The National Weather Service warning people from the Vermont border all the way down to the Connecticut River in Holyoke. In Vermont, a potential life-threatening situation for some, where the Weather Service's Burlington office says the state is under a flood warning and could be under a more serious flood watch. And, locally, they're talking about any number of situations, including in Holyoke, heavy rain sweeping through Holyoke, where the Connecticut River was just shy of being designated at flood stage. If the water reaches 9 feet, it's considered to be at flood stage. The Connecticut River yesterday was shy of that, hitting 8.8 feet.
Wow.
As of 2 o'clock yesterday afternoon. You had damages and closures at Brunel's Marina. They had damage to their docks. The Oxbow crested yesterday. Parts of Route 5 along the Oxbow, where that section is, that had been closed in both directions. They were saying that they were going to reevaluate that this morning. I haven't been able to check, where that stands now. But motorists are being advised to avoid affected areas, seek alternative routes, don't stand around riverbanks, don't try to be nosy and think that you can handle, walking by a flooded area or walking in the water. Don't be stupid.
That's the best summation of that. Just don't be an idiot.
Yeah, because, people just assume that, I'm not actually in the water. Being on the banks, I'm perfectly safe, except that part where the ground and the dirt below you washes away, and then suddenly you're basically walking on a balsa wood cover.
Yeah, it goes back to what we were talking about with first responders and stuff like that. They have to put it all on the line, sometimes.
Yep.
Why? Don't make them put it on the line because you decided you wanted to go out on your boat this weekend because it's July and you were going to go and everyone else be damned. You know what I mean?
There's been boat damage, dock damage, not just because the water is running high, but because of some of the things that are flowing down from Vermont into this area.
There were whole cars underwater, houses underwater. It doesn't look like Vermont in these pictures that I'm looking at. It looks like Mississippi. Remember you used to see Mississippi River flood and that's you just see tops of houses and stuff like that?
Yeah.
It's incredible that that's only a few hours away from us.
And even actually an hour north of us in some areas. I mean, Montpelier's up there, but Shelburne's had some issues. It's scary stuff. So if you're in a situation where the water is flowing really, really high and, hopefully in the next couple of days it won't it won't rain, even though tomorrow is looking like there could be a stray shower or thunderstorm. Do yourself the right thing and don't try to be a tough guy about it.
Yeah,
don't be stupid.
Oh, I'm gonna take my kayak and I'm just gonna go fishing.
I'm gonna go swim in some contaminated river water. What could possibly go wrong?
Yeah, we've already told you the turd cast is a dark brown today, so just stay out. We need a sponsor for that.
So desperately, we really do. And yet, much like that and breakfast for us, none of that is here.
Not one. No one even came in with a ham, egg, and cheese.
Nothing. And a bunch of disappointments you people have turned out to be. The Pioneer Valley forecast today, sunny and partly cloudy, high of 91. Tomorrow, like I said, stray shower and a thunderstorm is possible with a high of 89. It's 70. Is it really 79? No, seven, I got 76. 76 right now. Down to Rock 102, Springfield's Classic Rock. It's 8:53 in the Black Crows with Bax and Nagel and Marty Caproni on Rock 102. Friday morning, it looks like we may be talking to comedian Yakov Smirnoff.
Oh, boy.
You know, you want to bring the comedy legends into the show as often as you can, and I can't think of anyone bigger than Yakov Smirnoff.
Right now.
Yeah, right now. Yeah. Top of his game.
You know what we should do? We should make the interview just dead serious. Be like, so where do you stand on the Ukraine? How do you feel about the... How do you feel about the recent incursion by the Wagner Group?
Yeah.
Start asking them debate level questions.
What's going on with that coup with Putin? Is that really happening? Yeah, I'm sure he's got at least a good 15 minutes on Ukraine. You bet.
In my country, crazy. Well, you've been here 45 years. It's your country.
Yeah. You haven't learned English any better, but just
that's a good point. I wonder. I mean, by now he's been here probably longer than he was in Russia.
By a long shot.
What are the chances that off air or off stage he speaks like perfectly fluent English and then it's time to go on?
I've wondered that. Like, remember Charo?
Yeah. Oh, yes. Yeah.
Okay.
I barely understand English.
Ooh, coochie, coochie. Remember that?
Yeah. Yeah.
She was in this country for 60 years.
Yeah.
And that accent was indecipherable for forever, you know, and I gotta believe that every time she cashed a paycheck at the bank, she was speaking perfectly good English.
They're like, cut. She's like, oh God, could someone get me to my trailer? This is ridiculous.
You know, this accent is hurting my throat. I need a lozenge.
Yeah, I wonder. I bet you he does.
Yeah, because I think I don't know if you've ever noticed this. Like, if you live in a certain part of a country. Of this country.
Right.
And you move down south for a period of time.
10 years, 15 years. You start.
Yeah. Then all of a sudden you start getting that drawl. You start talking like that. I knew a woman that I went to college with. She was from Houston.
Yeah.
And she had a wicked, thick Houston Texan accent.
Yeah.
Really, really bad. She moved to Minnesota.
And it was like, hey, guys.
And I talked to her on the phone like 2 years ago, and all that Houston drawl was completely gone and replaced with exactly that.
Oh, yeah. Good. All right.
Oh, yeah. I see.
Oh, you guys are great.
I was like, Kelly, what happened to your voice? This is, am I sure it was the right person?
You know how it happened? I know. My cousin moved to Texas, and I noticed when he moved, it progressed. And the gateway drug, if you will, to a southern accent is y'all.
Yes, that's a dead giveaway.
It starts with y'all, and then the next time you see him, it's like, oh no, and then before you know it, you're racing ATVs in your front yard, and you know,
yep,
it's a slippery slope.
Like if you're from the south and you move to New England and you start adopting our. Local accent.
Yeah.
Although Western Mass, we don't really have it. But
I had this conversation with someone the other day. They said, you don't have a funny accent. You don't say park the car.
No.
But you know what I was told was that in Western Mass and Northern Connecticut, we do have an accent, but it's not an accent. It's, I don't know what they call it, affectation or whatever, but we speak fast is the characteristics.
Well,
mostly.
That's because we got so many things to do out here. We don't have time for idle chit chat.
Well, this is true. You go to like a Pride or a Cumbie's or whatever. You walk in, you want that transaction over with as fast as you can walk in.
Mm-hmm.
You go down south at a gas station and you're like on your way to get somewhere, and you got to sit there behind the guy who's like, "Yeah, how's your sister doing? Things are good. Yeah, bo." And mm-hmm. they have a conversation for 5 minutes, and no one has any of that anxiety. Like, I got to get where I got to get.
No one's in a rush.
Right, right.
Whether it's a conversation, if you're in a line, you got no problem listening to that guy's long, boring story, even if it's inconveniencing your time.
Well, and with no self-awareness whatsoever, everyone just completely disregards everyone else. And this is what you do. You got to be polite.
It's 8:57 with Bax and Nagel.